Hi, I'm Garnet Gilmore, the Director of Marketing and Sales for Warwick Forest. Today, I'm filming in our Commons Community Room. During normal non-pandemic times, we use this room for a variety of reasons. Most of the time, you can find our residents sitting here with a glass of wine, hanging out with their neighbors and friends, or reading a book by the fireplace. We hope you enjoy today's lecture. You're going to hear from Dr. Alexandra Ward. Dr. Ward earned her medical degree from the University of Medicine and Dentistry of New Jersey in 2012. She completed an internal medicine residency at the University of Maryland Medical Center, where she was selected to be a chief resident. Dr. Ward then completed fellowship training in cardiology at the Jefferson Heart Institute in Philadelphia. She is board certified by the American Board of Internal Medicine. She is a registered physician in vascular interpretation. She believes in the importance of listening to her patients and sharing decision-making, actively engaging patients in all aspects of their care. Dr. Ward has a special interest in women's cardiovascular disease, including diagnosis, treatment, and prevention. Her interest began during residency when she became increasingly aware that women's cardiovascular disease is different in presentation, diagnosis, and management as compared to their male counterparts. Dr. Ward is passionate about educating her patients and colleagues about these differences. Born in New York City and raised at the Jersey Shore, Dr. Ward is new to Hampton Roads. She is excited to explore the area's history and learn to paddleboard. In her free time, Dr. Ward enjoys being outside, especially at the beach, as well as spending time with family and friends. We hope you enjoy today's lecture.
Good morning. Thank you, everybody. I hope you all can hear me. I'm Dr. Ward. Thank you for the warm introduction. And I'm also the director of the Women's Heart Center at Riverside. So I did want to talk today, since it is the end of Heart Month and Women's Heart Month, talk about heart disease in women particularly, and really focus on what that entails, you know, who gets heart disease, why it's such a big issue, and then what we can do to help prevent it. So please feel free in the comment section to leave comments throughout the talk. You know, I'm happy to have this be as interactive as y'all want it to be. So please feel free. Anytime there's a question, just drop it in the chat box. And with that, we can go ahead and get started with the PowerPoint. All right. So as we know, women are from Mars. Men are from Mars, I'm sorry. Women are from Venus. So understanding heart disease in women, and I hope by the end of this, you'll see that heart disease is very different in women than it is in men. So we'll go through the outline. We'll define what heart disease is. So when we say heart disease, what do we mean by that? It's a very broad topic. So we'll focus on what exactly it is we're talking about, why we care about heart disease in women, risk factors that are specific to women for heart disease, symptoms, diagnosis, treatment, how to decrease your risk, and then I'll end a little bit with the Women's Heart Center at Riverside. So defining heart disease, all of this encompasses what we think of as heart disease. What most people think of when they hear the term heart disease is coronary artery disease, or CAD. And most people think of that as a big blockage in a coronary artery greater than 70% that causes symptoms and may need intervention such as stent placement or bypass surgery. There are other types of coronary artery disease that we'll get into in a little bit. Other things that fall under the definition of heart disease are abnormal heart rhythms or arrhythmias, such as atrial fibrillation, atrial flutter, et cetera. Congenital heart disease, or things that people are born with. Valvular disease, which can be primary valve issue, acquired valve disease, can be due to infections, et cetera. Heart failure, both systolic and diastolic. So systolic would be a problem with the pumping function of the heart, and diastolic is a problem with the relaxing function of the heart. Infectious etiologies, and then inflammatory. And under inflammatory, I will point out that COVID-19 and the issues that we think cause the problems with the heart that COVID-19 causes are an inflammatory process. So you get inflammation of the heart due to COVID-19 infection, and that's referred to as a myocarditis, which just means inflammation of the myocardium. So heart disease in women, that kind of was the definition of all heart disease. And there are some specific subsets of heart disease that are more prevalent in women. And if you've been to any of my previous lectures, you'll see that we've spoken about some of these before. So MANOCA, or myocardial infarction with no obstructive coronary artery disease, is something that's much more prevalent in women. So it is damage to the heart muscle that we see by an enzyme called troponin in the blood that is leaked when the heart muscle is damaged. So we see the troponin, but when they do a cardiac catheterization or let's say a coronary CT, there are no obstructions greater than 50 to 70%. So we'd say, well, normally we think about heart attacks as being caused by big obstructions in vessels, and we know that that's actually not always the case. Microvascular angina can cause MANOCA, or it can cause anginal symptoms without heart damage. Spontaneous coronary artery dissection, Takotsubo cardiomyopathy or broken heart syndrome, and coronary artery vasospasm are all things that fall under that MANOCA category and are all much more prevalent in women than men. So why do we care about heart disease in women? And why do I speak on this so much? So heart disease is the number one cause of death in women. It caused almost 300,000 deaths in 2017. It is responsible for one in every three female deaths. So one in three women will develop heart disease in their life, and one in three women will die from heart disease. So if you think of your mothers, your sisters, your wives, your daughters, your friends, and think of how many women you know, one in three will die from heart disease. So it really is very important that everyone is aware, number one, that heart disease is the number one killer of women and what we can do to prevent it. So one woman dies every minute from heart disease. So we've been here together for 7 minutes. So seven women have already died from heart disease just during that short time. So it's a huge impact. One in three females has some form of heart disease, which we've already spoken about. One in 16 women aged 20 or older has some form of coronary artery disease. So the reason that I highlight this is that we tend to think of heart disease, one, as a disease of men, and then as a disease as we get older, which we know is actually not always the case. So more women die from heart disease yearly than men do, and young women get heart disease, and young women die from heart disease. So for these reasons, this is why I talk about this so much. This is why we have a heart center, Women's Heart Center at Riverside, because it really does impact pretty much all women and really everybody, because everybody knows women. Everyone has women in their lives that this will impact. So very important to know about, to talk about, and to be aware of. So here is just a trend from 1979 to 2009 showing cardiovascular disease mortality. The light blue is women and the dark blue is men. And as you can see, we've done a good job in decreasing death from heart disease overall since the early 90s, but we have not gotten to the same level in women than men. And again, this just shows that more women die yearly than men do. And so the other reason to keep having these talks and to talk about this frequently is that only 44% of women are aware that heart disease is the leading cause of death in women. And this is actually down in a study that the American Heart Association has recently done, where they looked from 2009 to 2019, what women knew about heart disease. And actually in 2009, more women were aware of heart disease being the leading cause of death and were more aware of the risk factors. And for some reason, over the past 10 years, those numbers have decreased, and they've decreased amongst younger women. So young women really are not aware of how impactful heart disease is. And then less than 25% of women recognize risk factors for heart disease, such as high blood pressure and high cholesterol, and less than 50% of women know the symptoms of heart disease. So really a lot of work we have to do in terms of education, just making people aware of how impactful heart disease is and what to be aware of and what to look out for. So this is that AHA 2009 special report that we talked about, and the white bars were from 2009 and the dark bars from 2019. And you can see saying what proportion of US women identified heart disease, heart attack, cancer, or breast cancer as the leading cause of death. Get my pointer here. So here's heart disease, and you can see that the percentages, it was almost 65% in 2009 were aware that heart disease was the leading cause of death. And now it's dropped to 43.7%, where cancer has gone up to 40%, and breast cancer has gone up as well. So cancer and breast cancer are not the leading causes of death in women, heart diseases. And when you put cancer together, it still falls, the numbers are less than heart disease in terms of cause of death. So for whatever reason, women are less aware of the fact that heart disease is the number one cause of death. So now does anyone have any questions about any of that before we move on to risk factors? No. Okay. So there are two types of risk factors that we think about when we're talking about risk factors for developing heart disease in women. There are traditional risk factors, and these are the risk factors as we go through them that I'm sure everyone here knows about and is aware of, and will go, oh yes, I've talked to my doctor about that, I know about those, and we're on top of all those. And then there are some risk factors that are specific to women that are maybe less recognized and less focused on. So the traditional risk factors are smoking, high blood pressure, diabetes, obesity, and high cholesterol. Sorry, I'm mixing words together, putting them together, making new words. So we'll go through each of these traditional risk factors, starting with smoking. Smoking is the most preventable risk factor in women, as well as the leading cause of heart disease in women less than 50. So I always tell my patients, if you do nothing else that I tell you to do, but you stop smoking, that's the best thing you can do for your health. It is a dose-dependent relationship, so the more someone smokes, the higher their risk. And secondhand smoke also does increase risk. So I've had patients who have stopped smoking, but their loved ones or their roommates or whomever they're with, on a regular basis, continue to smoke, and that will continue to increase their risk. So it's very important that people stop smoking, but also not be around secondhand smoke. High blood pressure is more common in women than men over the age of 55. And the risk for developing heart disease if you have high blood pressure is higher in women versus men. So if a woman has high blood pressure, there's a 36% chance of developing heart disease versus a 19% chance in men. And there's a threefold increase if that top number is greater than 185. So this is why it's so important to be aware of your risk and also to ensure that you're treating, if you have any of these risks, these risk factors aggressively, because the risk is high. And for women particularly, it's higher than men for developing heart disease. Diabetes. So women who are of what we call childbearing age or premenopausal are protected against heart disease. We tend to think and we see that women who are of childbearing age, which also means that they're still menstruating regularly, have protection against heart disease. And this is thought to be due to estrogen, and estrogen that the body is making. So not estrogen that you're taking in, with hormone replacement or anything like that. It's estrogen that the body itself is making. Diabetes takes that protection away. So a younger woman with diabetes no longer is protected against heart disease just because they're premenopausal. And a female with diabetes has a threefold increased risk of developing heart disease versus men. So again, while these risk factors are present in both men and women, having diabetes and high blood pressure leads to a higher risk of heart disease in women than a man with the same risk factors. Obesity. A BMI greater than or equal to 40 increases mortality in women. It's thought to be also related to metabolic syndrome and polycystic ovarian syndrome, which we will get into shortly. So we do have a question: are the reasons for women older than 55 having more high blood pressure issues than men known? Not that I have seen. There are some thoughts about that, potentially due to the vascular changes that occur with age, and again, the changes in estrogen, but nothing that I've seen that's definitive as to why that's known. Okay, and then high cholesterol. So 48% of women over the age of 20 have a total cholesterol greater than or equal to 200. And our goal cholesterol for everyone is less than 200. So almost half of all women over the age of 20 have high cholesterol. 32% have an LDL greater than or equal to 130. And cholesterol levels do increase after menopause. HDL, or good cholesterol, inversely predicts heart disease in women. So the higher your HDL, the lower your risk of heart disease. And having high triglycerides increases risk for developing heart disease by 37% in women versus 14% in men. So once again, this is a risk factor that both men and women share, but if women have it, their risk of developing heart disease is higher than men. So this is why it's even more important to be very aggressive with these risk factors in our female population because of these elevated risks as compared to our male counterparts. Now, that's not to say that men should not also be aggressively treating their risk factors. They for sure should be. But most men are aware of the risks of heart disease, whereas women are not. So that's why we really want to focus on this, because most of our female patients just aren't aware of how impactful and important this is. And this slide, I'm sorry, it's kind of a condensed slide, just goes over again the traditional risk factors and the sex-based differences. And then there are some recommendations from, and this is in from Circulation, of what are the things that we should be looking at. So for diabetes, the recommendation, of course, is aggressively treating diabetes and really getting good A1C control. For high blood pressure, really aggressively treating high blood pressure. And there are different issues in terms of what is the appropriate blood pressure, and that's something to talk to your doctor about. Those numbers have been changing recently. We do have some newer guidelines that are really saying that everyone's blood pressure should be less than 120 over 80. But we do have another question. What would cause total cholesterol and LDL to suddenly increase when diet has pretty much stayed the same? So this can be for a few reasons. One, and the most important, is whether or not the cholesterol panel was done fasting. I mean, totally fasting. I've had some patients say, I only had a cup of coffee with a little bit of creamer, and I've seen wild elevations in cholesterol from that. So if that was not an issue and there was, you know, no food or beverages before the lipid panel was done, it can be for a variety of reasons. It could have been that something had changed in the diet recently, or something has just changed in the body. So sometimes our cholesterol production and how we manage cholesterol changes for certain people. Some people respond very nicely to medications, and then some people it takes a few medications to get cholesterol under control. And we don't necessarily know why that is for each person. Normally, if someone has very hard to control cholesterol and it's been high throughout their life, it's normally genetic. And that's something that we have to be more aggressive about, because diet and exercise will not help with that. If you say, you know, I've done everything exactly the same and all of a sudden my cholesterol has shot up wildly, I normally recommend repeating the lipid panel just to make sure it was accurate. Sometimes there can be lab error, but if it is accurate, it could just be that the way your body is managing cholesterol or making cholesterol has changed. Okay, and that brings us to dyslipidemia on this chart and the statins. So statins are equally effective for secondary prevention in men and women. And there's a note here that they said randomized trial evidence in women for primary prevention is limited. So primary prevention is to prevent heart disease from happening, and secondary prevention is something has already happened, heart disease has been diagnosed, and now we're trying to prevent anything else from happening. So there have been more recent trials that have shown that lipid control and the statins in women particularly are effective in preventing heart disease. And I always argue that anyone who needs to be on a statin should be on a statin, and every single person can be on a statin. It just matters which one, the dose, and how frequently. I always like to say, never Google statins. There's a lot of bad information on the internet. All right. And then going through obesity and physical inactivity. So really, women and men should both strive for a healthy BMI and good heart healthy diet and exercise. What is DM? I'm sorry, what do you mean by DM? Just write down, if you can tell me what you mean, I can answer the question more. So for heart healthy diet and exercise, so everyone should follow heart healthy diet and exercise. And that is going to be, I like the Mediterranean diet. I also hate the term diet, but I do, it's what's called the Mediterranean diet. It's lean proteins, whole grains, and then fresh fruits and veggies and healthy fats. So that is really a good, well-rounded, heart-healthy diet. And then activity, at least 20 to 30 minutes of activity daily is what is recommended. And even walking, so just getting out and walking 20 minutes a day, really is impactful and really does make a difference. And then of course, totally have not seen any of my patients develop diabetes from the statin therapy. And again, in terms of the muscle aches, everyone can be on. I've had patients who've come to tell me they cannot be on statin therapy. You know, they've tried everything and I've gotten them back on statins, even if it's just 3 days a week. Some statin is better than no statin. And coenzyme Q10 with your statin therapy can really, really help in preventing those muscle aches. And so I do recommend, if you have any concerns about statins or you're recommended to take a statin, but you're worried about taking it, to talk to your doctor about the use of potentially coenzyme Q10 as well. Okay, so those are the traditional risk factors, and we'll move on to the female-specific risk factor. So women's hearts are different than men's. And we'll go over that a little bit more. So on the left side, again, we talked about these traditional risk factors that we all know about. But here on the right side are some emerging non-traditional risk factors. And about half of these fall into complications that have occurred during pregnancy. So this does not mean just women who are pregnant currently or who just recently delivered. This is at any time during life. If any woman has had any of these issues with pregnancy, they're all separately independent risk factors for heart disease. So that includes preterm delivery, which I believe they say is greater than 34 weeks, hypertensive disorders of pregnancy, which include gestational hypertension, preeclampsia, and eclampsia, gestational diabetes, small for gestational age. So those all, if any female has had any of those during a previous pregnancy, those are things that we really then want to look at to say, okay, that's a risk factor for developing heart disease because you've essentially failed nature's best stress test. So we're going to be more aggressive with the traditional risk factors and making sure we're really keeping your blood pressure at goal, your cholesterol at goal, your A1C at goal. Other risk factors specifically that women have that increase risk for heart disease are autoimmune diseases such as rheumatoid arthritis or lupus, anxiety and depression, and certain breast cancer treatments. So we'll go through those in a little bit more detail. So going into the female-specific risk factors, PCOS or polycystic ovarian syndrome, which fell under the traditional risk factor of obesity that was mentioned in there. We'll talk about it more here. They think that it's related to a few things. One is the increased prevalence of metabolic syndrome, which metabolic syndrome is normally related to obesity or being overweight, and also can have dyslipidemia or that abnormal cholesterol in there as well. The risk of cardiovascular disease is higher if they're irregular menstrual cycles, and even greater if very irregular. And with patients with PCOS, there's an increased risk of seeing cardiovascular disease or coronary disease on angiography, meaning if we do a cardiac catheterization, we see plaque, we see buildup in the arteries. Increased risk of coronary artery calcification, which also leads to an increased risk of coronary disease. And an increase, the risk is both from the metabolic syndrome, but also that hormonal dysregulation. Because as we did speak about, estrogen is cardioprotective. And in women with PCOS, those estrogen levels are very variable. And because of that, that's why they think that women with PCOS have this higher risk. Menopause. So there's an increased risk for heart disease after menopause. So if you break down when men and women are developing heart disease and when the most women are developing heart disease, it's after menopause. So after endogenous estrogen falls, and then men and women develop the exact same risk of coronary disease and heart disease. So as we said, estrogen is cardioprotective. So most younger women do not have significant obstructive coronary disease because of the presence of estrogen. Once menopause happens, that protection goes away, and men and women are equal for developing obstructive coronary disease. That's not to say those other things we talked about, those MNOCAs, those can happen before menopause. So those are still present, and that's why young women particularly can still have heart disease. It's just not falling into that obstructive coronary disease that we normally think of when we're talking about heart disease. There's an increased risk if there's early menopause, and if the menopause is surgical, so meaning if a woman had a hysterectomy and a total abdominal hysterectomy, so the ovaries were removed, that risk is even greater than if it was a natural menopause. And of course, it's due to the loss of ovarian function resulting in decreased endogenous estrogen, meaning decreased estrogen the body is making. So the difference between cholesterol deposits and calcifications, pardon me, is twofold. So cholesterol deposits, And I think what Jimin also is the plaque buildup. So that's atherosclerotic plaque. So there is some cholesterol in there, and there's also an inflammatory component. So macrophages, which are part of our immune system, are present in the plaque. And so we know that there is cholesterol, but there's also inflammation. Calcification is not something that we necessarily see when we do cardiac catheterization or angiography. Calcification is something that we can see on imaging studies, such as a CAT scan, a coronary CAT scan, MRI, things of that nature. So, or a coronary artery calcium scan. That just shows us calcium in or around the arteries. It doesn't necessarily always mean that there's calcium in the artery. It can be around the artery. So sometimes we see big buildup of calcification on an imaging study. And when we do the cardiac catheterization, there's very minimal blockage. So there's great flow through the artery, but there's calcium around it, if that makes sense. So there's they're caused by different things. The cholesterol or the plaque buildup is actually in the lumen of the artery and causes obstruction. Calcification can occur on top of those cholesterol deposits. If it's been there for a while, calcium will just build up, or it can occur outside of the artery or in a further out wall of the artery and does not cause an obstruction that we can see on angiography, but does portend increased risk for heart disease, if that makes sense. So it is something we use, coronary calcification. If we see it, we treat people like they have coronary disease, but it doesn't necessarily mean it's obstructive coronary disease from a plaque, if that makes sense. So going back to the female-specific risk factors, and again, this just goes over those pregnancy complications and heart disease risk. So if anyone has had any of these complications that are here, you would want to speak to your doctor about that, having increased risk of heart disease and being very aggressive moving forward about aggressive with your risk factors in terms of decreasing them. And so how do you treat calcifications? The same way that you would treat. And I know I said they're different and they are different, but you still treat them the same as you would if you had a blockage or any plaque in the artery. So aspirin, statin therapy, and excellent blood pressure control. We use coronary calcification seen on imaging as a way to say your risk of having heart disease is higher. So if you've heard of the coronary artery calcium scores, we use those scores as a way to determine whether or not someone would meet criteria for statin therapy if their cholesterol was not elevated to the point where we would traditionally treat. So calcification in coronary arteries is a way for us to change risk stratification. So we treat exactly the same as we would if there were cholesterol deposits, because we know that by seeing calcification, the risk of developing blockages gets higher, even though it doesn't necessarily mean that there's a plaque in the artery. So I know that's kind of, say, well, does that really make sense? But it's again, just that the risk is there and we know the risk is going to be higher. Okay. And going to those female specific risk factors with cardiovascular complications of pregnancy, the hypertensive disorders are the most common and they're listed here as chronic hypertension, gestational hypertension, preeclampsia, eclampsia, the metabolic disorders of pregnancy, which is gestational diabetes, preterm birth, and low for gestational age birth weight. The hypertensive disorders of pregnancy. So chronic hypertension is a blood pressure greater than or equal to 140 over 90 that was diagnosed either prior to pregnancy or earlier than 20 weeks gestation. Gestational hypertension is the blood pressure greater than 140 over 90 diagnosed after 20 weeks gestation. Preeclampsia is chronic hypertension or gestational hypertension plus protein in the urine or signs of systemic disease. And we do that by doing some laboratory work and other urine studies that is diagnosed either early before 34 weeks or late after 34 weeks. And eclampsia is preeclampsia with grand mal seizures. And so, you know, we say, why do we care about the hypertensive disorders of pregnancy? Because the increased lifetime risk of all of the following is higher. So hypertension, high cholesterol, metabolic syndrome, coronary artery disease, stroke, peripheral arterial disease, endothelial dysfunction, and having blood clots in the venous system. All of these are increased if you have had a hypertensive disorder of pregnancy. And that's even if blood pressure returned to normal after pregnancy and no medications were needed after pregnancy. If a hypertensive disorder of pregnancy occurred, the lifetime risk of all of these has already been increased. And then preterm delivery and small for gestational age. Preterm delivery, again, associated with increased risk of developing heart disease. Offspring's birth weight actually predicts maternal lifespan. And low birth weight, less than 2,500 grams, is associated with ischemic heart disease or blockages in the coronary arteries, heart failure, hypertension, core pulmonale, or right-sided heart failure, and lower HDL levels, which we know HDL in women protects us. So if they're lower, then we don't have that protection. And then gestational diabetes. The prevalence is 2 to 11% in pregnancies. It's diagnosed after a glucose tolerance test. And there's three things that can happen with a tolerance test. It's either normal, it's impaired, or gestational diabetes. Gestational impaired glucose tolerance and gestational diabetes both increase risk of heart disease. And it's basically because the pancreas has failed to respond appropriately. And the risk in women is, if they've had this during pregnancy, they're increased risk for developing diabetes and developing metabolic syndrome, which we know, again, are risk factors for heart disease. Okay, so those are the risk factors for heart disease, both the traditional that we find in both men and women, and then the female-specific risk factors. And if there's any questions about those, please do put them in the box, as y'all have been doing, and we'll go through them. Now moving on to symptoms of heart disease in women. So the most common symptom of, and when I say heart disease, now I'm talking about coronary artery disease and heart attack specifically, because that's when we tend to say, you know, what are the symptoms you're going to be feeling? We're talking heart attack. The most common is chest pressure, and that's the most common for both men and women, is a chest pressure, feeling like someone's sitting on your chest. That is the most common. In men, that tends to be the most common and one of the only symptoms. It may be associated with some shortness of breath, but it tends to be chest pressure radiating to an arm, radiating to the jaw. That tends to be the most common. In women, while chest pressure is the most common, it's also associated with all of these things below. So pain, discomfort in the arms, neck, back, jaw, or stomach, nausea, diaphoresis, or feeling hot and sweaty all over, indigestion, back pain, and extreme fatigue. And this is what I hear the most too, is I've had women, and I recently just had a patient who came in with this saying, you know, she had chest pressure, but also just extreme, extreme fatigue, well out of proportion to what she was doing. And the problem with these symptoms in women is that while chest pressure is the most common, when it's associated with all of these other things, and often it is, it makes it challenging sometimes for both women and providers when they come to the emergency department to say, is this heart disease or is it something else? And because most women do not realize that heart disease is the most common cause of death, nor do they recognize the symptoms, they don't put these together. And they don't say, okay, well, I'm having chest pressure, indigestion, and I'm extremely fatigued. I must have just overdone it. I'm going to go lie down. When in fact, they really should go to the hospital. So these are the things that make it challenging sometimes for deciphering what's going on. Is this really heart disease? So it's important to know these symptoms and to be on the lookout for them. Because as we always say, if you're having a heart attack, time is myocardium or time is heart muscle. So we want people to come in as soon as they start having symptoms so that we can make sure we can act as quickly as we need to. Additionally, I will say, unrelated to this talk, but related to the current pandemic that's going on, we've seen people not want to come to the hospital or not want to come to doctor's offices for fear of getting COVID, which is a very reasonable thing to think of. But I would say the hospital is one of the safest places to be right now because of, you know, everyone is fully masked, gowned, gloved. We have basically bathe in sani wipes every day. So it's a very safe place to come. And people should come to the hospital if they're having any concerns for heart attack or any other issue. Okay, and we have another question. Are the higher heart disease rates for women related to women being the ones who gave birth? So yes, this would be a pregnancy that resulted in delivery. Now, what I would say if there had any issue with delivery or any issues with the pregnancy later that resulted in the death of the fetus or the baby, that would still lead to increased risk of heart disease. So if there was gestational hypertension during a pregnancy, and if the pregnancy resulted, let's say, in a late miscarriage or something of that nature, or something else happened, it still does lead to increased risk. But yes, it would be in pregnancies in general, I guess. So anyone who had been pregnant with any of these things would be increased risk, if that makes sense. Let me know if it doesn't. And so here's, again, I really like these CardioSmart informatics. You can actually go to the CardioSmart website, which is part of the American College of Cardiology, if you just Google CardioSmart ACC, and they have these very nice infographics about what to look for, what to be on the lookout for, and you can share these with family and friends as well. And here are, again, just the risk factors and the heart attack symptoms that we just talked about and why we really need to be aware of them. So the pregnancy risks are the same if the mother delivered twins rather than a single birth. So the one question, and I hear this a lot too, is, well, with twins, a lot of the times preterm delivery occurs because of twins, and they're small for gestational age because there was two of them as opposed to one. So they just don't have enough room to grow. That risk would not be a part of that. So if, you know, they delivered at 34 weeks and they were appropriate for twins, and it was an appropriate time for twins, then it would not be increased risk. However, it was very early delivery for twins, or the twins, or even if it was, you know, multi twins, triplets, etc. If it was very early, so earlier than what they would have expected it to be, or if they were much smaller than expected, and that those risks would still be there. So it's really, if it's not what was expected for pregnancies that are more than one child. Okay, so that's symptoms. And if anyone has any questions of the symptoms of heart disease, please do drop a question. And now going to diagnosis. So how do we diagnose this and say, you know, what are the things we should be asking when we go see our doctors? So the biggest thing is a comprehensive history and physical. So really, you know, going through the whole history, physical examination, and going through the entire OB history. So I ask all my female patients these questions about their OB history, regardless of their age, when I see them, and family history, and any of those risk factors that we spoke about. Those should really be flushed out and talked about at length at the initial visit. Sometimes an EKG is appropriate. Lab work can sometimes be appropriate, especially when checking for lipids and A1C. Occasionally, we will do cardiac imaging, such as echocardiogram or ultrasound of the heart, cardiac CT, cardiac MRI, and that coronary artery calcium score that we discussed. Now, not everybody needs these tests or these images. These would just be some of the modalities that we use if there's something else we're looking for. Stress testing and catheterization. So again, not everyone needs these, but these are just some of the ways that we diagnose. And treatment. Okay. So we'll go through, this is from a nice update for the guidelines for preventing heart disease in women. So evaluating risk we talked about, and then there are some things we can do. So one, we're talking about implementing lifestyle changes, which is recommended for all. And so this does fall under treatment, is lifestyle changes. So that's smoking cessation, the DASH-like diet or the Mediterranean diet, regular physical activity and weight management. If there's a history of atrial fibrillation, yes, then we would recommend anticoagulation if appropriate. If a woman is at high risk of having cardiovascular disease, which is any one of the following, so that's heart disease that we know about, stroke, peripheral disease, an abdominal aortic aneurysm, diabetes, chronic kidney disease, or a 10-year risk greater than or equal to 10%, then we would recommend and they're asking if they have heart failure. So if they have any recent events or procedures, then cardiac rehab and these other recommendations, which are aggressive blood pressure control, getting LDL less than 100, or if patients have coronary disease or prior stroke or peripheral disease, getting an LDL less than 70, beta blocker therapy and angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. So those are the ACE inhibitors or the ARBs. And then let's go to, if someone does not have any of these risks here, then we would still say blood pressure control, LDL therapy or statin if the LDL is greater than 190. This has actually now changed. It's lower now. So we think sometimes 180, where we'll start thinking about statin therapy. And then also treating for high LDL triglycerides in select women and aspirin therapy. So aspirin is a tricky one. Aspirin does not help prevent heart disease in women as primary prevention. It helps prevent stroke. So if there are risk factors for stroke, which are actually very similar and the same risk factors as heart disease, then it would be appropriate, such as high blood pressure, diabetes, high cholesterol. So those are things to talk to your doctor about, but I would not say just start taking an aspirin because you want to prevent a heart attack. That's something to really talk to your physicians about and your providers to ensure that that's the appropriate thing to do. Okay, so these up here are all class one recommendations, meaning that everybody should be doing them. Class two recommendations are, we have good evidence for them, but we can say, you know, if there's a reason to not do them, then we don't necessarily need to do them. So goal less than 70 in very high risk women. And again, that's women who have coronary disease or stroke, LDL less than 70. Non-HDL lowering therapy, goal less than 130. Glycemic control in diabetics, aspirin or antiplatelets, and omega-3 fatty acids. So again, aspirin does not help prevent heart disease, but it does help prevent anything from happening if you've had an event. So aspirin is always used for secondary prevention in women, not always for primary prevention. Does estrogen therapy after menopause help prevent heart disease? That is an excellent question. And the answer is no. So they looked at this saying, you know, we know that estrogen is cardioprotective. So why don't we just put everyone on estrogen therapy? Everyone should get hormone replacement therapy after menopause, and then women won't get heart disease. That actually has been shown to not be the case. And in some cases with hormone replacement therapy, they've actually shown that cardiac events went up. So for whatever reason, when you take estrogen that's not made by the body, it doesn't react in the same way, it doesn't work the same way, and then cardiac events actually increased. So they do not recommend hormone replacement therapy for everybody. It is something to discuss with your providers and to see if you would be a candidate and what would be appropriate. But no, it's not something that we routinely recommend. Does fish oil supplement raise your total cholesterol? It can. Not always, but it can. So before taking fish oil or omega-3s, you definitely do want to talk to your physician and your providers to see where you are in your numbers and if it would be beneficial or not to take. But yes, it can definitely raise your cholesterol in some cases. Okay. So going again to treatment, so we have blood pressure control, lifestyle changes, which is weight loss if needed, increased physical activity, alcohol moderation, lowering your sodium consumption, and increased fruits, veggies, and low-fat dairy. And we do recommend therapy if blood pressure is greater than 140 over 90 or greater than 130 over 80 in patients who have kidney disease and diabetes. These numbers are actually even tighter than this now. This was in 2011. There are newer guidelines. So we dropped these numbers down. So now really 130 over 80 is considered a time we would start blood pressure medication in everybody. And it used to be, you know, if your 120s over 80s, it was considered normal blood pressure. Not anymore. It has to be less than 120 over 80. Again, we really want to have good lipid control. And if we can't achieve that with diet and exercise, then adding medication. And just here, again, this will go through. I'll leave this up so everyone can kind of look through and see this and look at the class level of evidence. Our best is class one level of evidence A or B. Dietary intake. Again, so this is for women, should have whole grains, high fibers, lean proteins, fresh fruits and vegetables, and healthy fats. Oh, and I actually will go back to this because this is the question about fish oil and omega-3s. They say it can be considered with high cholesterol or high triglycerides for primary and secondary prevention, but they have variable amounts of the active ingredients. And again, in some people, it can actually raise cholesterol. So you do want to make sure if you're going to do that, that you do talk to your provider and physician. For prevention of coronary disease in women, you know, we've kind of gone over this already, but so this is a nice table that just puts it all together. So stopping smoking, increasing physical activity, and cardiac rehab if needed. So if something did occur, if someone did have a heart attack or needed a stent placement or had angina, then cardiac rehab is a wonderful tool. Aspirin should be used in women who have heart disease, in women with diabetes, because diabetes is a coronary artery disease equivalent. And then they says it can be used for women greater than or equal to 65 years of age to prevent ischemic stroke, NMI, if the risk of bleeding is low. And again, for women less than 65, it prevents only ischemic stroke. So that's something to definitely talk to your doctor about. And then for atrial fibrillation, the anticoagulants are listed. Beta blockers, ACE inhibitors, and aldosterone blockade. If women fall into the categories of having any of these, they should be utilized. And the reason I put this in here is that we know that women are less likely to receive goal-directed medical therapy than their male counterparts. So these are the things that all women should be getting, just like men. And again, I'll leave that there because I know y'all will have this just to peruse and look over. Okay, and in terms of specific dietary intake recommendations, here's how they all fall in. I will draw your attention to sodium, less than 1500 milligrams today or less than 1.5 grams per day. So really do you want to make sure that our salt intake is low? And decreasing risk. So how do we decrease our risk? So one is knowing what our risk is, talking to your doctor and providers about your risk factors and making sure that all of your risk factors are under good control so that if you have high blood pressure, it is well controlled. With diabetes and high cholesterol, the same thing, that you're at a healthy weight and you're doing as much physical activity as you can. And I know, pardon me, with the pandemic, it's been hard, especially because gyms are closed and the weather has not been nice, but there are many things you can do at home. You can walk around the house. There are YouTube videos. My mom actually does them. She just YouTubes. I think she's told me that she YouTubes elderly women. What did she say? It's something about older women at home workouts was her Google search or her YouTube search. And she found these great things and she has done wonderfully. Her arms look better than mine do. So it definitely can be done at home without equipment. So there's a lot that you can do to make sure that you're staying active, even during the pandemic, even without going to the gym, even without being able to walk outside. And then risk factor modification, like we discussed. Okay. And I'll just end briefly talking a little bit about the Riverside Women's Heart Center. And of course, if there's any questions about anything we've spoken about, please do fill them in the box. So we treat women who have had any of the following. So who are currently pregnant with palpitations, shortness of breath out of proportion to being pregnant, chest pain, or prior heart disease. Patients who've had any of the following complications during prior pregnancy. So no matter their current age, if any of these had occurred during any prior pregnancy, then we would definitely say they should be referred to the heart center. So that's any of those hypertensive disorders of pregnancy, gestational diabetes, preterm birth, small for gestational age, or peripartum cardiomyopathy. And then any of those cardiovascular disease processes that we know are more prevalent in women, so that's SCAD or spontaneous coronary artery dissection, vasospasm, microvascular angina, Takotsubo cardiomyopathy, any of those Minokas, or family history of preterm cardiovascular disease. And this is the Women's Heart Center group. So this is me, of course. And Donna and Rachel are two of the nurse practitioners who are part of the Heart Center. We all work very closely together and have a great interactive collaborative group. So if there is any, that we all work together and we're part of the Riverside Women's Heart Center. And our locations are in the Newport News office, the Port Warwick office, Hampton, Gloucester, and Williamsburg. And then questions. Broken heart syndrome. So Takotsubo cardiomyopathy, they initially refer to it as a broken heart syndrome. It is what we call a stress cardiomyopathy. So what we would be seeing it in primarily, and the reason they called it broken heart syndrome was if someone had a sudden catastrophic event that occurred. So the unexpected loss of a loved one or a traumatic car accident, for example, these things all can lead to this stress cardiomyopathy, and it's due to a surge in catecholamines, and it leads to what looks like on an echo, they call it an octopus heart. That's what Takotsubo means, is octopus pot, because the heart looks like this octopus pot that is used, and that's why it's called Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. So there's ballooning of the apex. Now, the problem with this is it looks also like if someone were present with this, people have chest discomforts, chest pressure, shortness of breath, all of the symptoms of heart attack. And this type of cardiomyopathy, the wall motion we see on echo, meaning these walls that are not moving appropriately, look exactly like an LAD distribution blockage. So one of the main arteries of the heart, the LAD, the left anterior descending, causes wall motion abnormality that looks just like Takotsubo. So we always do have to do a cardiac catheterization if we see this. And if the coronaries are clean or open and there's no big blockages, then we say it's a Takotsubo cardiomyopathy or a stress cardiomyopathy. So while I, you know, put in the parentheses broken heart syndrome, because that's what it's normally referred to, it's really a stress cardiomyopathy. And it's due to that catecholamine surge that has caused it. And the treatment for it is actually the same as any cardiomyopathy or any issue with the pumping function of the heart. Beta blockers, ACE inhibitors, or angiotensin blockers, spironolactone if the ejection fraction is less than 40. Oh, wonderful. There's a virtual web movement class for ages. Excellent. Love it. Yes. Wonderful to do. Lightheaded after bending over or stooping, and heart rate varies when standing from sitting. Oftentimes, that can be related to being dehydrated. So it's orthostatic hypotension. Our heart responds to blood pressure to make sure that our body is getting enough oxygenated blood. So if you stand up quickly and your blood pressure drops, your heart rate goes up to compensate for it, and you can feel lightheaded or dizzy. If that's happening, definitely talk to your doctor or provider. They'll check something called orthostatics, so your blood pressure and your heart rate when lying down, sitting, and standing. And if it changes by a certain level, it's positive. And then we recommend really making sure that people are staying adequately hydrated. Most people do not drink enough water, myself included. And so I recently bought myself a jug that's half a gallon, and I make sure when I'm at work, I drink that entire jug. So I'm now drinking at least 80 ounces of water a day, which I know I wasn't doing before. And I feel you can tell the difference. So you really want to make sure that you're drinking enough water, especially if you've had any caffeine during the day, coffee, sodas, teas that are caffeinated. Those are all dehydrating. So you need to make sure that you've rehydrated yourself. And juices, sodas, things of that nature really don't count when we talk about hydration. It's really water. And if you're like I am, I do not prefer the taste of plain water. So I put some lemon in the water, or when it's the summer, I like to put some berries and cucumber in just to give it a little bit better taste. It helps me drink more water and ensure that I'm actually getting as much as I need for the day. Of course. Are there any other questions about any of that? That's hard to say. Good question. If there's a pain in your chest and back when you first wake up, but it's gone soon after you get out of bed, is there an issue? Hard to say, honestly. Normally, when we think of angina, an angina being cardiac chest pain occurred from a blockage greater than 70%, we normally think of that as being due to exertion. So when people exert themselves, they feel it. When they stop, it goes away. That's classic anginal symptoms. We worry when it does not go away quickly, or if it happens with minimal exertion or no exertion, then those are reasons to immediately seek medical care. If it's just in the morning when you wake up and you get out of bed and you start moving around and it's totally gone and it never comes back throughout the day, then likely not. But it is something always to talk to your provider and physician about, just to make sure that, you know, you've done everything you need to do to get it checked out. There's a lot of things in your chest. And I always say this when I see patients, there's lots of things in our chest that can cause discomfort. I would argue the most important is your heart, but I'm biased. But so once we check that out, and if the heart looks good, then, you know, making sure it's not something like a musculoskeletal issue, you know, could there be a strain or something like that? shortness of breath if all heart and pulmonary tests are okay? So, excellent question. If people are short of breath, and I'm assuming you mean with exertion and not just at rest, so let me know if that's not correct. Shortness of breath with exertion, that, and all the heart tests and lung function tests have come back normal, tends to be, from what we can say, is deconditioning, or that we're not as active as we used to be. So once we've done all those tests and we say, okay, these things look good, the heart's good, the lungs are good, but people are still feeling short of breath, it tends to be that we have to work up to whatever we're trying to do. So I tell my patients, you know, if you're getting short of breath with walking a block, and again, all of our testing has been normal, then walk a block, wait, catch your breath, and go walk another block. And to keep doing things like that, to build back up, or to even build up what happened. Because when we feel short of breath, we tend to stop doing what we were doing because we get short of breath. And when we stop doing that, then we lose that conditioning that we had. And so it is always important to get checked out and to make sure the heart, the lungs, everything is okay. But if everything comes back normal, then that just means, oh, you know, now we've lost some of that because we were waiting to make sure everything is okay. Now we have to build it back up. And even doing some of those rehab programs we talked about can be very helpful because those are monitored. Any other questions I can help with? And again, the Women's Heart Center is available. There is a referral process. If anyone says, you know what, I do fit into criteria and I would like to come, you know, be seen by the Heart Center, we do have our PCPs who can refer from, you know, all across the board. So you can always let them know. We're always happy to see anybody. Women can come directly to us or by referral. It really depends on insurance, actually, whether or not, if your insurance needs you to have a referral from your primary to come see a cardiologist, because we are all within the cardiology group, but any of the PCPs can refer to us. There is a separate Women's Heart Center referral. I don't have a book that I recommend. I have a handout in my office that I hand out about the Mediterranean diet. This is the one time that I say it is okay to Google the Mediterranean diet. If you just, you know, type Mediterranean diet, you'll find some recipes and things of that nature. It is lean proteins, though, whole grains, heart healthy, you know, fruits, veggies, and healthy fats. You know, I don't think I didn't put our phone numbers up. I apologize for that. But if you just go to the Riverside cardiology page, if you go to any of us, you'll find our information with our offices. I am the only one who goes to Gloucester and Williamsburg right now. So if you're in those areas and wish to be seen, you would see me in the offices in the Newport News Hampton area. You'd see any of the three of us. Really do, you know, in our heart center, we're really trying to increase education, not only to the community, but also amongst providers as well, because it is something that's not as well known. And so we do want to make sure that we are making as big of an impact as we can and keeping our women safe and preventing heart disease. And let me see, I'll try and get you, I gave you one link. I can give you my link, I think. Let's see. Oops. Not really a lot. And there's that link, there is to my page at Riverside directly. So if that gives you all the places that I see patients at and all the phone numbers. So that's how you can easily get to the Heart Center as well. How did I end up at Riverside? My sister actually lives here. And when I was leaving fellowship and saying I wanted to, where was I going to practice? You know, Riverside had an opening and I said, well, she's here. Let me come on down and and we'll spend the weekend and see. And she really loves the area as well. And Riverside was very open to starting a Women's Heart Center because I am the first female cardiologist that they have had recently. Dr. McCormick was there before me, and she had retired, so we hadn't had a female cardiologist for a few years in the interim. So they were looking to fill that gap when she retired, and they were very open and willing to start the Heart Center. So I've been here about a little over a year and a half, and this has been something that we've been working on and is up and running. As you know, it does take a little bit of time to get anything up and running, but we are finally up and running. And I will say the Heart Center is not a standalone place. So it's not like you can go to one Heart Center. And the reason for doing that is we wanted to make sure that patients could come to all the different offices, you know, didn't have to go to one place. So we really want to make sure that we are accessible to everyone who wants to come see us. Thank you. Thank you for coming. Very much appreciate it. All right. Any other questions? Thank you. Thank you for having me. I appreciate it. All right. Well, if no other questions, thank you again. And until next time.